is established pursuant to Section 519.13 of the Ohio Revised Code by the Anderson Township trustees to provide administrative relief to any person or entity adversely affected by the Anderson Township zoning resolution. Will the secretary please call the roll?
Rick Overschmidt?
Here.
Brian Ellis?
Here.
Fred Hayes?
Here.
Brian Johnson?
Here.
Thank you for coming to this meeting. Please be aware that this meeting is audio and videotaped and may be carried live on our local cable television. I'll outline our procedures for each case. We do have a very full agenda tonight, so we will try to keep things moving. A summary of the appeal was presented by the staff, and then the appellant will present its case. Board members may then ask questions of the appellate. After that, all persons supporting the appeal will be permitted to testify one at a time after being recognized by the chair. When those persons supporting the appeal are finished, those opposed to the appeal will then be permitted to testify and or ask questions after being recognized by the chair. All persons wishing to testify, whether before or against an appeal, may do so only after being sworn in. When testifying, each person should come forward to the podium. Pick either one, they're both on tonight. Speak into the microphone and state your name, address, and affiliation to the case, if any. All persons testifying are limited to 4 minutes unless the board grants additional time. Please address the testimony to the board with no comments to the audience, please. The board will hear only new non-repetitive evidence or questions. Should someone wish to so support a previous testimony, they may just state so rather than restate what the person in front of them just said. Now, if anybody wants to testify this evening, please stand, raise your right hand. When in doubt, stand up, because if you think you're going to talk, do it. Repeat after me. Do you swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you God? Thank you. Any changes to tonight's agenda?
None.
Okay. First up, approval of the minutes of April the 4th. I would ask that to help Betty out on the minutes going forward, to be careful that we're speaking into the mic when we are talking. Sometimes we turn away and sometimes we turn our mics off, but do ask that we do a little better job of speaking into the mics. I know that Fred gave comments to the minutes, as did I. Any other comments or changes?
No. Not? And those comments were received and made?
As well as yours.
Yep. Mr. Chairman, I move to approve the minutes as amended.
I'll second.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you. Okay. First case, 6-2013 BZA. If staff would like to give us a summary of this case, please.
Sure. The applicant on this is Brandy Lindbrock, the property owner of 1664 Beachshire Drive, which is zoned B residential. The request is a variance to allow an accessory structure to be a chicken coop, 44 square feet in size, located in the rear yard area with a setback of 17 feet.
Your mic's not working.
With a setback of 17 feet from the south and 20 feet from the west property line, where 100 feet is required from every property line per section 62.14-5 of the Anderson Township zoning resolution. Here's a location map of the property. Highlighted in red is the address we are concerned with. You can see surrounding residential zoning on all properties, as well as an aerial photo of surrounding conditions. The home on the property in question was constructed in 1986, and there are no other accessory structures in the rear yard, and no other zoning certificates are on file for the property. This is a proposed site plan. The structure is proposed to be located 17 feet from the south property line, which in this photo is to the north, and 20 feet from the western property line. The variance, as staff finds, is not substantial. The structure will be located so as to shield its visibility from surrounding properties, and the structure will not be visible from the roadway. You can see here an example of the proposed structure. The essential character of the neighborhood will not be substantially altered, and adjoining properties will not suffer a substantial detriment as a result of this variance. The applicant is proposing a structure of an attractive design to be located amongst mature landscaping. The variance will not adversely affect the delivery of government services, and the property owner's predicament cannot be feasibly obviated through some method other than a variance. Though the applicant is aware that free-range keeping of hens is not prohibited through the zoning resolution, her desire is to provide a safe environment as well as an attractive structure for their keeping. Here we have photos of several surrounding conditions. The structure is proposed to be located in this area.
Any questions for staff on this?
Yes, Allison, I could clearly see that part of the property from the roadway. So how did you see that the coop would not be visible from the roadway?
Well, it was staff's assessment that located amongst mature landscaping with additional landscaping in that area that it would not be readily visible.
So there is additional landscaping planned?
Where the site plan is. The applicant may be able to more speak to this site plan.
Okay.
All right, any other questions for staff?
Mr. Chairman, I'm going to recuse myself from this case. The applicant's husband and I serve on a scout committee together.
Okay, thank you, Brian. Cyril, if any questions?
No questions.
I just have one clarification, Allison.
Yes.
It's not the hens that require the zoning.
Correct.
It's the structure
of the
houses.
The location of the structure.
Thank you. Okay, would the applicant like to come forward and state their case? If you give us your name and address, we appreciate it.
My name is Brandy Uhlenbrock, and I live at 1664 Beachshire Drive. I'm requesting to build a chicken coop in my backyard to provide me the opportunity to raise chickens. The coop I've selected will be integrated into professional landscape and very much looks like a garden shed. I'm aware there's other opportunities or options for me to house chickens, but would like to do so in a comfortable environment to shield them from protection. My neighbors, my immediate neighbors are on board with it, and we hope to use it as an educational opportunity for our children. I grew up on a farm and was in 4-H for 10 years and would like for my son to have that same opportunity.
Questions of the applicant?
Do you plan additional vegetative screening around this structure?
I do. My brother-in-law is a landscape architect, and I add tons of plants to our landscape every year, so that's something that I'll continue to do.
There's not a great deal of space there. Is the plans to essentially shield it on both sides?
It will be on both sides by, do you want me to tell, like by hydrangea is what I have in mind, and then there's some mature hosta that I will replant around it.
Okay.
No questions.
The landscaping plan that's included, the one that's up on the screen now, is that existing or proposed or a combination of both?
It's a combination of both.
Okay. Thank you. Another question for you. Drainage from this, I mean, how are the wastes handled? In terms of water runoff running through, carrying any of the wastes away?
The coop that I hope to put there is raised. There's a chicken run underneath of it, so I'm hoping that all the waste will be contained in the upper level that I'll be able to put in a wheelbarrow and then put on my garden.
Okay. Thank you. Other questions?
No further.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Would anybody else like to speak in favor of this application? Would anybody like to speak in opposition to this application? Hearing none, let me explain a little bit about our process. We hold these public hearings, we then close the public hearing. We will internally debate the case, usually this evening, I'm sure it'll be this evening, and then take a straw vote, and then maybe either later this evening or the next meeting, take a formal vote once it's all typed up. But we will close the hearing and then move on to the hearing for the next case. Okay? Hearing nothing further, close the public hearing in case 6-2013 BZA. Next up, 7, Forest Hill School District.
Yes, this has been submitted to us by SFA Architects on behalf of the Forest Hills Local School District, who's the property owner. This location is at 7560 Forest Road. It is zoned both B residential and C residential, though primarily in the B district. This request is for a conditional use to allow a detached accessory structure in the side yard area, where it is required to be located in the rear yard per section 171.7. And then the overall conditional use is for the high school to be located within a residential area. This site is approximately 8 acres and has 415 feet of frontage on Forest Road with relatively flat topography. The applicant is proposing the installation of a 15.5-foot by 16-foot high canopy with a 19-feet, 6-inch height. The structure is to replace the existing fuel island canopy, which was recently damaged. The use of the site as a high school is the conditional use in the residential zone, and this is just an associated use with that. Here we can see an aerial photo of the surrounding conditions, as well as the site plan showing the existing, as well as the proposed location for the canopy replacement. Elevations of the proposed structure, as well as an existing photo of the location of the structure. So the conditional use standards for single and multifamily residence district were established by the Board of the Trustees on May 31st, 2007, and the existing fuel area was constructed prior to that establishment. So we look at several findings in this, both the conditional use standards as well as the variance standards. So staff found that the vehicular use area will not be altered through the replacement of the canopy. The replacement of the canopy will not introduce any new noise, odor, vibration, or dust in the area. No landscaping is being proposed, no signage is being requested, and any lighting will be provided to aid in the refueling process and will not be directed onto adjacent properties. Staff is of the opinion that the essential character of the neighborhood would not be substantially altered and adjoining properties would not suffer a substantial detriment as a result of the variance requested, as the property is currently used for this purpose. The variance would not adversely affect the delivery of government services. The property's owner's predicament could not be feasibly obviated by placing the structure in the rear yard, as the existing fueling area cannot be easily relocated. The spirit and intent behind the zoning requirement would be observed and substantial justice done by granting the variance, as the structure being proposed will not alter the character or activities currently taking place on site.
Okay. Any questions for staff?
I had a question, Mr. Chair. Allison, I remember when we did the sign for the high school, it's a conditional use, but is it this property has never gotten overall conditional use, so is that why we consider conditional use every time we do an incremental
correct
item with the
yes
property?
The sign actually came to us as a variance request as opposed to a conditional use. All conditional uses are permitted to have a sign up to 32 square feet, so that variance was just for the size being larger than that. The previous item that we looked at the conditional use standards on would be that the baseball announcing area and concession
right
stand. So each time an improvement is made on this property, unfortunately, it does have to come back before the BZA, no matter how small.
Okay, thanks. No more questions.
Sure. Yeah, I have one follow-on question, Allison. The definition of the side yard versus the rear yard in
yes
this conditional use situation, this canopy is still well behind and well set back from the road.
Yes.
Could be interpreted to be in the rear yard, but for some reason we see it as the side yard?
Yes, the rear yard, the aerial photo might be the most visible. The football stadium is located in the rear yard and anything behind that area would be. However, in this case, the rear yard wouldn't really start until this line.
Wow.
Behind the building.
Okay. Yeah, well behind the entire building.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
I'm sorry.
No questions.
I was just going to ask, could you show another one where it where the canopy is relative to the side of the building, or, let's see.
We can sort of find it on this aerial photo, if I get my mouse back.
Mr. Hayes is pointing.
Roughly in this location.
Yep.
Okay, so, yeah. It is back pretty far.
Side yard, oh, it's well back, yeah.
Thank you.
No further questions for staff. If the applicant or applicant's representative would like to come forward and present your case to us.
Good afternoon. My name's Tom Fernandez with SFA Architects. We also have Ray Johnson, the business manager for the Forest Hills Local School District. In terms of the facts on in this case, I think Allison has done a wonderful job in describing the situation. It's a case where an existing canopy, we're replacing it. The size of the canopy is approximately the same, but there is a slight difference, and I do want to point that out. The canopy is about 2 feet 10 longer in one direction and about 8 inches wider than the canopy that was damaged and replaced. It is also about 1 foot 6 inches higher. So I do want to make sure that we're on the record noting those differences. The length and the width was the additional length and width was put towards the back of the property, not towards the front. So we're not any closer to the adjacent property line than previously. Than we were previously, and it is approximately 64 feet 4 inches to that nearest property line. Other than that, I think it's a pretty straightforward situation. We actually debated on whether we needed a permit because the Ohio Basic Building Code allows for replacing like-kind elements, but since there were some variations in the canopy and in discussions with Allison, we thought we'd go through the process. Thank you.
Thank you. Any questions of the applicant?
Well, one quick question. The difference in the dimensions you just described, Mr. Fernandez, those are reflected in your drawings, correct?
Yes. These are the actual dimensions of the new canopy.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Other questions? I have one or two. Hold on. Don't sneak away too much. Some of this is for the record. The exterior lighting on this, is it straight down? Is it, to what extent? I know it's the applicant said it won't be visible from the neighboring property, but is it
right?
Down?
Any service lights, we always make sure that they're shielded. It is just for lighting that specific area. So any service lights that are installed would have shields, downward shields.
Okay, and then just for the record, the ability to relocate this is hampered by the fact that there are underground storage tanks and things for the fuel tanks. Is that and the drainage for that?
It would be about a $500,000 expenditure.
So that's what I wanted to get on record. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Sure. That's it.
Any other questions? Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Would anybody else like to speak in favor of it? Mr. Johnson?
Yes, I'm Ray Johnson, the Director of Business Operations for the school district, and I just wanted to add that for the record, the reason that this is being replaced is we had a semi-driver, a delivery driver, trying to find a location in Anderson Township, got lost, entered our property on January 24th, took out the canopy, which we had to remove that day for a safety issue. So it's only being replaced because it was damaged, and the insurance proceeds are picking up the full cost of that as well as.
And it wasn't a high school kid.
No. So, and he actually wasn't looking for us. He was looking for some other business, but happened during the school day to decide to turn around in our parking lot. So.
Thank you. Any questions of Mr. Johnson?
No.
Okay. Thank you. Anybody else speak in favor of this? Anybody care to speak in opposition to this case? Seeing none, we'll declare the public hearing on case number 7, 2013 to be closed. Next up is 8-2013 Puppywood Pet Resort.
Sure. This was submitted by Jason and Antoinette Messman of the Puppywood Pet Resort on behalf of DRB Consultants II Limited, the property owner. This is located at 7863 Beachmont Avenue. Its zoning is e-retail and C-residence. The variance request is to allow an 8-foot-high privacy fence in the rear yard where 6 feet is the maximum height allowed, and this area is to contain boarded animals outdoors at a location of approximately 76 feet from the residence district where a distance of 200 feet is required. Here we can see a location map showing both the e-retail zoning as well as the C-residence portion of the parcel. So previous tenants of this commercial facility have most recently included Sonny's 3 Meat Burger as well as Extreme Sound. Puppywood Pet Resort obtained a change of use zoning certificate to operate an indoor dog daycare in March, and the request was in compliance with section 102.2 of the zoning resolution. And at this time, they are submitting this variance request for the containment of animals outdoors. Here we can see an aerial photo of surrounding conditions, as well as a site plan detailing the proposed improvements upon the property. So staff feels that the property can yield a reasonable return without the granting of a variance. The applicant has stated that it is possible to operate without the use of an outdoor area. Staff found that the variance was substantial. The proposed setback of the fenced-in area is 76 feet from the residential district zoning line, where 200 feet is required per section 102.2 of the zoning resolution. Adjoining properties may suffer a substantial detriment as a result of the variance. It is not clear how potential noise concerns will be alleviated, and the tenant had knowledge of the zoning restrictions through the process of applying for the change of use zoning certificate. Here you can see photos of surrounding conditions, both of this structure to the east, as well as looking north at the property in question, and then south at surrounding conditions.
Questions of the staff?
Yes, please, Mr. Chairman. Allison, you state that the properties to the east are commercial shopping and residences. I saw it as commercial, but it's probably residence, zone residence, because of that extension, that stub to the south.
This existing property or the property to the east?
Well, the property to the east, I think for the most part, is commercial.
The property to the east is zone E retail. It does have an apartment upstairs.
Oh. Ah, okay. Thank you.
Other questions of staff, Brian?
Is there an existing fence on the property?
No.
Is that the property behind it? Is that their fence?
It's right on that line. Actually, it might be a little further in than that, yes.
The drawing, could you help me with that a little bit
sure.
more? It's orange and yellow, and those are both
yes, to fenced, di- to no, to distinguish in? The difference between the 8-foot-high privacy fence in the rear. In addition to that, a 4-foot-high fence to be open is proposed on the eastern portion of the building, just as kind of a backup measure. There are doors that open to the outside there that in the event of a fire or anything, if those were to open to prevent any dogs from getting to Beachmont Avenue.
Oh, okay.
And
thank you.
Both of those require a variance?
If the 4-foot high fence is to be 75% open, it does not.
Okay. And to the request for the variance is for both the fence and for the use?
Yes, it's kind of twofold. The first portion would be for the height of the fence to be 8 feet rather than the 6 foot maximum allowed. And then the second part of that would be that this area is proposed to contain the boarded animals.
All right, and just to clarify, the zoning certificate's already issued for the primary inside use.
Correct.
So we're only here to talk about the outside use and the fence.
Correct. We had several inquiries to appeal the initial decision to issue the zoning certificate for the indoor use. However, to date, no appeal has been filed.
Okay. Thank you. Would the applicant like to come forward and present its case to us, please?
Good evening. Thank you for allowing me to come to speak today. My name is Jason Messman. My address is 4923 Laurel Avenue, Luash, Ohio, 45242. And just wanted to go over a few of the concerns that I'm sure that you folks have, as well as some of the residents in that area concerning the fencing variance that we're requesting. Our number one priority for considering this is, as Allison mentioned before, is for the safety of the animals. As you're aware, the roadway 125 is extremely busy. The doorways that lead out in the event of an emergency situation, such as a fire or some other evacuation, we do need a way to make sure that the animal's safety is taken into consideration so that they cannot exit the building and simply go into the highway. So that's a number one priority for us, is to maintain the safety. In addition to that, our other considerations for the fencing itself, we wish to be one of the premier choices for individuals in this area for their pets' care, for daycare and boarding. And one of the ways that we're able to provide that is to be able to provide both an indoor area and an exterior area. It's very important for our customers to be able to have that. But in addition to that, one of the concerns that I'm sure some of the neighboring communities have is the noise level. And actually what we found is the noise level is actually reduced significantly when we're able to have both an indoor and outdoor play area. Simply the act of being able to move dogs from one area to the next tends to create a calming nature. It keeps them occupied, keeps them moving about, and actually reduces the amount of noise and level of barking, and also keeps the animals calm while they're there. So we feel that it'll actually be better for the immediate neighbors to be able to have that as part of our facility. And that's one of the reasons for the 8-foot high request as well, is we feel that additional height will allow the noise, instead of traveling horizontally, to be reflected more up and out, so that it will be less of an impact on our neighbors, because we definitely want to take everyone into consideration and want to make sure that we maintain a level that's comfortable for our neighbors as well. And in relation to the distances from the properties, we understand that the neighbors to our east and to our west are zoned commercial, and we are actually if you take a look at the top right picture that's shown there, that shows the rear of our property. Directly behind that is a substantial parcel of property that goes back where there is no residence on the property. That, I believe, is technically zoned residential, but as I understand it, that's going to be possibly changed to a commercial at some point in the future. So our nearest actual residence that's zoned residence is, I believe, in the range of 160 to 175 feet away from our property. So it's getting very close to that 200-foot mark as well. So we feel that our impact on our residential neighbors will be very minimal.
Questions of the applicant?
The structure of the fence is 90% open? Is it chain link?
What we would prefer, what we feel would look nicer for the neighborhood, is to not have a chain link fence. We would prefer to have a high-grade white PVC vinyl. We think it looks much better for the neighborhood, as opposed to having, you know, what would I think downgrade the neighborhood by having a chain link fence. And it is set directly to the rear of the property, so the visibility from the roadway would be minimal. So we feel that, you know, that in addition to the other reasons would be beneficial.
But the side door fence is chain link.
That we can't, we would make a concession on that if that was important to you folks to have that as a 90% open, because it would be a much smaller area, and I don't think it would be as detrimental.
Any questions?
I'm not sure if it's appropriate to ask staff again.
Sure.
What does the...
This, the four-foot-high fence to the east is required to be 75% open or greater by the zoning resolution. So in that area, a Kentucky board style with liner would be appropriate, split rail, all of those would consider to be 75% open.
Actually, my question was going to be more at the, what I'll say, speculative zoning changes in the property to the south. That the applicant has said that that is likely to change to commercial. I wanted to hear from you.
I don't know that it has not been filed for to date, but I don't know if that property owner has plans to do so.
So at this point, it is completely speculative?
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Is it possible to deny the where it's located, but grant the 8-foot requirement, or grant where it will be, but make it 6 feet? Is that an option? Or is this an all or nothing?
No, I mean, there's two variance requests included in here. You can grant one variance request and deny the other variance request, and you can grant conditions to it, so.
Yeah, and if I may, that if that's something that would assist and be more in line with what you folks would like, yeah, that would still fall within what we're trying to accomplish safety-wise and things of that nature. So, again, our feeling is that it would actually be better for the neighborhood to have a higher fence and safer for the dogs to have a higher fence, but we would be able to work within those parameters for a 6-foot-tall fence as well. And just for clarification, if I'm not sure if this will clarify it at all, but I believe that property from my research to the south of us is actually owned by the township.
Yeah, this parcel is. Which were you asking me about?
That parcel, the first one.
Okay.
Yeah, from my understanding, that what I was led to believe is that might be turned into a causeway from King Louis Court in behind those businesses.
I had a question for you. Could you explain how often there will be dogs outside in the enclosed area?
Absolutely. And this is something I think I outlined in the letter as well. We certainly don't keep the dogs outside all day. It's actually minimal amount of time that that we would have them out. It's usually just to kind of keep them, you know, one of the benefits of having that outside area, it would be contained within what's called canine grass. So it would be much like their normal environments. They would be able to go outside and do their business instead of going on the concrete. So we usually take them out several times a day, you know, at least 3 or 4 times a day, where they would be out for maybe a 15 or 20 minute time period and then brought back in. And these times would be not late into the evening. You know, we have certain hours where we operate during the day. So there would be no, typically the last time that we would take the animals out for the day would be around 6 to 6:30. So it wouldn't be late into the evening, and it would not be before 7:30 or 8 o'clock in the morning.
And how many dogs would an area like this support, or would your operation tend to have at one time?
It depends on the time frame of the year. You know, during our busy seasons are typically when kids are out of school and people are traveling. But what we like to do is keep the play sizes small. So generally speaking, there wouldn't be more than, you know, 10 to 15, maybe 20 in outside at one time before we bring them back in. And again, we would keep into consideration, we have a facility in Montgomery, and we have neighbors there as well. So we're considerate in that area as well. If the noise level does increase at all, you know, our employees know to bring them back inside to change their environment. So we would definitely take into consideration noise level and wouldn't simply allow, like probably many of you have heard, neighbors' dogs just sitting at the fence and barking all day long. That is definitely against our policy, and we would, you know, prevent those type of things from occurring.
And when you applied for the permit back in March and got the zoning permit, Were you informed then that that the outdoor area required a variance?
Yes.
All right, thank you. Other questions of the applicant? Thank you.
Sure.
Anybody else care to speak in support of this application? Would anybody like to speak in opposition to this application? Yes, sir. Please come up to the mic and state your name and address.
My name is Roger Stone. I live at 1258 Immaculate Lane, which, by the way, is to the south of this location. I appreciate the owner's concerns, but the owners live at Blue Ash. They don't live right behind this facility. They were granted 22 kennel space for interior kennel, not exterior. I have grandchildren. I question how many people are watching the dogs. What if the dogs get out from underneath the fence? 8 foot is an awful tall structure. I consider a PVC 8 foot structure in the windstorm. How long is it going to take to blow that down? How are the dogs going to be attended? How many people are going to stay out there with the dogs, or are the dogs just left free out there to not do anything? I'm concerned about the smell and also about the noise in it. And that's my concerns with the property.
Thank you. Hold on. Any questions?
Could you identify exactly where you live, sir?
I think the red triangle is. Not the first house, but the second house on the Immaculate coming up.
And on the right?
It would be on the right-hand side, yes. Right there.
Right there.
That's correct.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Any other questions? Would anybody else like to speak? Yes, please. If you'll give us your name and address, we'd appreciate it.
My name is Janine Full. My husband and I have lived at 1268 Immaculate Lane for 31 years. I am extremely disturbed at the thought of having barking dogs very close to my backyard. That's my oasis. That's my peaceful time. And to have dogs out at 6:30 at night barking, the fact that it's basically an open toilet, as far as I'm concerned, I don't care how much disinfectant you put down, and the devaluation of our home, the possible resale value, are big concerns to me. And I would ask you whether you would want this very close to your own homes.
Thank you. Was there any questions?
I had a question. When the car stereo guy was back there,
mm-hmm.
did you hear that?
Frequently. Some people called and complained.
And can you hear noise from Beachmont Avenue?
Yes, somewhat. It's muted, and after all these years, you pretty much learn
right.
to just let it go.
Thank you.
Any other questions?
Yeah, I was going to ask about the noise from Beachmont.
Okay.
That it?
Thank you.
Thank you.
Would anybody else like to speak in opposition to this? Yes, please.
My name is Dennis Corrales, and I own the property directly to the east, which is currently being occupied by three apartment renters. And I know that my particular situation, being that it is owned commercial, not residential, really doesn't apply due to the Section 102.2. only affecting residential property and not commercial property. But I do have a concern that, you know, my renters are going to have a problem with actually their windows being right next to that that no open area there. And I'm here on their behalf, basically. I just wanted to file that.
Thank you. Any questions? No? Thank you. Would anybody else like to speak in opposition? Nobody else wants to speak in opposition. The applicant will have a chance to come back up and answer any of the questions that were raised. Or
well, thank you very much for your concern. Again, I do appreciate that, and I do live in Blue Ash. I'm not going to live behind this facility, so I can understand why, you know, as a homeowner, these would be some concerns of yours. And I would like to address some of them if I can, and hopefully to your satisfaction. As far as, I know someone mentioned the smell, which is definitely a concern. If you were to walk into our facility in Montgomery, and I certainly welcome you to do so, one thing that you'll notice when you walk into that facility is that you cannot tell that it is a pet resort. That's one thing that we pride ourselves is in taking exquisite care of our animals, and one of those things is making sure that things are kept extremely clean. We use non-toxic cleaners, and we have a staff that is very conscientious and work around the clock to make sure that that is one thing that is, you know, never an issue for our facility, and you can always go on to any one of the review websites, and that's one thing that you'll find very in common, is people mentioning how clean our facility smells. So that's one concern. You know, as to the sound of the animals, I completely understand that as well. I have neighbors who live very close to me, you know, at a fence line away, and they have dogs that stand at their fence and bark all day long. I obviously am an animal lover, you know, dogs are my best friend, but certainly not the ones that bark all day long at the fence. And once again, I completely understand that that would be a concern to you folks, and we would take utmost care to make sure that as our neighbors, and you would be our neighbors now, that you wouldn't have to be concerned, you wouldn't have to make phone calls. If there were any issues, we would make every opportunity to perhaps change our scheduling if that would be the case. You know, maybe have them go out at 6 o'clock and maybe only in, you know, 5 or 10 dogs at a time if it became an issue. But I can tell you we've never had a complaint in the 5 years that we have been in Montgomery, and we have neighbors that are closer than you folks are. As to the height of the fence, again, if that's a large concern, 6 foot would be fine with us. You know, if they determine that that would be more appropriate, we could certainly do so. As to the care of the animals, someone mentioned, you know, how many people would be taking care of the animals? Would they just be let to roam free? That's certainly not the case. We have employees that are there that are watching the dogs 100% of the time that they're out playing. So at no time would the dogs ever be unattended, simply let to roam free and do as they wish. There will be an employee in each one of our play areas with each one of the groups of dogs at all times. So we, and this is for two reasons. You know, one is the noise level, that we want to make sure that the dogs, if they are becoming, you know, get riled up a little bit, that we can move them back inside. And two, for the safety of the, not only of the animals themselves, but also of any neighbors. We certainly don't want them to, you know, find a way out of our facility. Our facilities are locked down tight, so they have no way of getting in, or, you know, anybody getting in or anybody getting out. And as far as the concern over, you know, safety, little children, things like that, you know, the only dogs that we accept in our facility are ones that pass a rigorous temperament test. So it's only the nicest, friendliest dogs that are even allowed in our facility. So I hope that those were the main concerns. I hope I covered them. If I didn't remember some of them, perhaps you could remind me.
Yeah, only the board can ask the questions.
Absolutely.
Any further questions of the applicant?
Okay. Yes, Mr. Chairman. There was a concern about the structure of the fence and could the dogs get out from underneath the fence. Could you address that plan of the structure of the fence?
Certainly. And that's something that we not only address at the beginning of construction, but also on an ongoing basis, our employees take rounds around the fencing to make sure that nothing has structurally become unsound. We have taken efforts in at our first facility where areas looked like they may potentially become unsound, in shoring those up and making sure that everything is completely sealed up tight. We bring the fencing down all the way to the level of the existing grade, and at our current facility had brought concrete up above the level of the actual fencing just to make sure that there was no way any of the panels could come loose or anything of that nature. And as far as the structure against wind and things like that, everything is set in concrete. You know, it's a very permanent structure, so as far as the structure becoming unsound, that's our biggest concern, along with all you folks, you know, is making sure that there's just no way that the animals could ever be allowed to get free from that area.
Any other questions?
Oh, another note that we've actually gone ahead and spoke to some of our neighbors as well, and actually one of the tenants in your property, we spoke to John. What was his
name? Just comments to the board, not John.
I apologize. One of the tenants in the property to our east, spoken to him. He's actually leasing the bottom side of that structure, and one of the other tenants who actually lives in the structure have both given their consent and blessing, and had no issue with what we were proposing to do here, as well as our commercial neighbors to the west as well in the dry cleaners. So
all right, thank you very much.
Certainly.
That concludes public hearing on this case, unless there's any reason to keep it open for any further information. Hearing none, we'll close the public hearing on case 8-2013. Move to case 9-2013.
Yes, this is located at 1002 Pamela Drive and is zoned A2 Residence District. The variance request is to allow a setback of 8 feet where 10 feet is required per section 72.2 for an accessory structure. Here we can see a location map. The surrounding zoning is all A2 residence as well as an aerial photo. In this aerial photo, you do see an existing garage to the rear of the structure. The house was built in 1959, and in 1999, a zoning certificate was issued for a 28 by 30 accessory structure. This was prior to a text amendment that the Board of Trustees made in May of 2007, which stated that any accessory structure greater than 15 feet in height shall be set back in accordance with the primary setback for that zoning district. In March of this year, this accessory structure was destroyed in a fire, and only the foundation remains currently. The applicant is requesting to reuse that existing foundation to reconstruct the accessory building. And as such, this setback does not meet the new regulation established in 2007. Here we have a proposed site plan just showing that location again on the existing foundation of the structure, as well as elevations of the proposed structure and photos of the existing conditions at the site. Staff is of the opinion that the variance is not substantial. The proposed location will have the same foundation as the previous accessory structure, as I stated. The essential character of the neighborhood would not be substantially altered, and adjoining properties would not suffer a substantial detriment as a result of the variance requested. The view from the adjacent home to the north would be screened by an existing 6-foot solid wood privacy fence, which was also constructed in 1999. The variance would not adversely affect the delivery of government services. The previous garage was built prior to the current regulations, and the property owner is replacing it in kind. And the property owner's predicament cannot be feasibly obviated through some method other than a variance. The new structure is proposed to be located on that existing foundation, which would be cost prohibitive to relocate.
Questions for our staff?
Thank you. On looking at that, if you go back to the aerial photo, yeah, so it's going to go where the existing one was, and it looks like there's really nothing by it.
Correct.
So there wouldn't be it wouldn't create a hazard necessarily if it's a little bit closer to the proper line because of other structure. Okay. And also looking at that photo, just on the right-hand side, up above it, north, and then actually due directly south, It looks like, are those also accessory structures on those other lots?
Yes, there are several accessory structures in the same area of similar size.
Okay. All right, thank you.
The height of the planned structure dictates the 10-foot setback.
Yes.
How high could it be and still would be within code for 8 feet setback?
Up to 35 feet. It was still in, for the 8-foot setback, it would need to have a height of 15 feet at the midpoint of the roof line.
That's what I was looking for and I couldn't find it. That's what I thought it was. Thank you.
And then just to clarify this, if this was sitting 10 foot away, it's mm-hmm. fine.
Yes.
It's only the 2 feet,
that 2 feet
where the existing foundation is.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you. Any other questions of staff? If not, would the applicant or his representative care to come forward? Thank you.
My name is Paul Fry, and I'm here to represent the applicant, Phil Bowler. Phil is also here. Phil and I are friends, and we've worked together in the past on several projects. He asked me to get involved in this for him. I don't know if it's appropriate or not, but I have a document that I would submit if it is appropriate. The document is a letter which I drafted asking for support of several neighbors, and Phil took it around to the neighbors and got signatures on it, and I'll give it to you for the text if it's appropriate to give you that.
Certainly.
One other thing that I would like to show you is a photograph of the original structure at the time it was built. Now, the downside of this photograph is that it does not show the driveway apron immediately in front of the garage. You can see that on the aerial photograph. Excuse me. And it does not show the landscaping that Phil has placed around the garage since the time it was built. This photograph was immediately after it was built.
The only problem with taking the photograph is we have to keep it for the record. Is that going to be a problem for you? I'll get you a photocopy of it or something like that, but thank you. Thank you.
For those that did not or cannot see that letter in this hearing, I believe there were 8 neighbors that signed that letter. I'm not going to go back over the history because I think it was covered very well, but the garage has been there since, well, about 13 years. Never have there been any complaints about it. I would point out one more time that there are several structures in the immediate neighborhood that are of similar size and similar character. Mr. Bowler has been at the property since 98. He has no intention of leaving. He runs a small business. He's a single employee, works for himself. And the garage is important to his livelihood because he keeps some tools in there. He's a small-time residential contractor, mostly remodeling. He keeps some tools in there, all of which were lost in the fire, unfortunately. But that's about the extent of the use of the garage, but it is important to his livelihood. The variance asked for here is very minimal. We're talking about a 2-foot variance. I understand and respect zoning codes. I'm on a board of zoning appeals myself. The character of this structure, we're trying to rebuild exactly the same structure is all we're trying to do. So it's not going to change. There's no public property involved, no impedance on easements or anything of that nature. The change in zoning occurred after he purchased the property. So at the time he built his original structure, it was quote unquote a legal structure. Fire destroyed it, and now he's trying to put back the same thing. So it's an unfortunate situation, but it seems unfair to him to be required to comply with current zoning codes on such a small issue, such a small variance. It will create a hardship for him in the sense that to try to comply in the sense that he would have to literally move the foundation, the existing floor slab, and there's a significant cost there. I mentioned in the documents that I submitted, that he went back for an insurance claim and got his garage paid for, but to the extent that they would pay for the structure that was actually destroyed. The slab and foundation were not destroyed, so they're not providing him with any reimbursement for that. So if he had to do that, that's all on him. And of course, that's a significant amount of money, so.
Thank you. Any questions of the applicant's representative?
Mr. Fry, it says in the letter that the use is going, you mentioned some of the things that will go on in there, but it's to keep some of his personal things, like his boat, motorcycle, pickup. Is that what you envision going on in the garage?
That was and will continue to be the primary use. I mentioned the business issue only because he keeps small amount of tools in there.
This says small hand tools.
Yeah, right, exactly. Yes. He has no backhoes or any significant equipment that he keeps in that. It's very small hand tools and
thank you.
Things of that nature.
Yes.
Mr. Fry, along those same lines, what's the use of the or planned use of the second floor on the building?
He does, as I said, small remodeling projects. From those projects, a lot of times he'll take out a wall and door frame. The door's still in good condition. The owner doesn't want it. He'll take it back to his property, put it up there, keep it, maybe use it on the next job. But it's from my experience, and I've, as I said, I've worked with him and known him for a number of years, been upstairs in his facility, it's a limited, very limited amount of storage. It's mostly personal storage.
Brian, any questions?
No.
Well, one thing I might add is that the second floor has I don't know if you saw the drawings or not, but it has a 5-foot wall at the perimeter, and then a scissors truss, which gives him a little more height than the middle, so he can walk the middle, but you can't walk the side of the perimeter.
Okay. No further questions of the applicant? Thank you. Would anybody else like to speak in favor of this application? Would anybody like to speak in opposition to this application? Hearing nothing, we'll close the public hearing on case 9-2013 BZA. Okay, case number 5 this evening, 10-2013 BZA, Endo
Last
Valley.
One. Yes, this is on 2209 Endo Valley. Travis Egan is the property owner. Its zoning is A2 CUP, which is Community Unit Plan, and it's a single family residence district. This variance request is to allow a pool located in the side yard area where it is typically required to be in the rear yard per section 171.7. The surrounding zoning is A CUP as well as some B CUP residents to the southwest. It's approximately 5.543 acres and has 178 feet of frontage on Endo Valley. The topography here does have a dramatic decrease in elevation to the north and western portions of the property, and the existing use is a single family home. Here we can see an aerial photo of that area. The applicant is proposing the installation of an in-ground pool size 18 feet by 36 feet within this side yard area with a patio and 4-foot high decorative aluminum fence. A zoning certificate was issued for the construction of a single family home in 2002, and no other zoning information is on file for this property. Here we can see a rendering both of kind of a close-up view of the proposed patio and pool area, as well as the location of the aluminum fence, and then also in context with the property. And here are some property photos of surrounding conditions. The applicant states in their application that there is a sewer easement in this rear yard area, and then as well as the steep topography, these are the things that are keeping them from being able to construct this within the rear yard as required. This view is to the properties to the south, looking at the street and then looking from the street area towards the home. Staff is of the opinion that the variance is not substantial. The proposed location of the pool is in the side yard area, and this has enough width to accommodate a 25-foot setback. The applicant is proposing a fence as well as landscaping in addition to the existing landscaping to screen the pool from the roadway. The essential character of the neighborhood would not be substantially altered, and adjoining properties would not suffer a substantial detriment as a result of the variance requested. The applicant has an adjacent home to the south, and this home is positioned to face Timber Creek Drive. So from a passersby kind of aesthetic, it'll look as if it has a backyard appearance from this property. The variance will not adversely affect the delivery of government services. The property owners propose to locate the pool away from this existing storm drain and easement. The property owner's predicament cannot be feasibly obviated by placing the structure in the rear yard, as the topography makes this unfit for development of this type.
Questions for staff on their report?
It looks like they'll need a fence around that, of course.
Yes.
It looks like the fence might get into the front yard area a little
yes,
bit.
Yes, the 4-foot okay? high decorative aluminum would comply with those regulations.
Okay. Thank you.
All right. No further questions of staff. Would the applicant like to come forward, present their case?
I'm Jennifer Egan. I'm Travis's wife. He's out of town on work right now. I live at 2209 Endo Valley Drive. And as you've seen, we would like to put a pool in our side yard due to the uniqueness of our property. We cannot put it in the back. We've had several people come out to take a look at this because of the situation of the storm drain. I've lived there for 9 years. We've landscaped and taken very good care of our yard. We plan to privatize this, and so that way it in no way affects any of our surrounding neighbors watching us in our pool. I have also brought this to our homeowners association due to any concerns, and because of the fence would not be from the rear plane back due to our covenants, and they have approved that variance for me as well. So I feel my husband has contacted all of our local neighbors and told them, you know, expressed the plans, talked to their concerns. There are a few people who are not happy with it, but that's kind of where I'm at. I feel like, you know, this is something that would bring joy and happiness to my three children, and we're hoping to be able to do this for increasing our property value to make our home more of a family home for us to hang out and enjoy and pursue.
Okay. Questions of the applicant?
It was interesting to see the aerial photo, because there's a substantial rear yard to that, but it's unusable. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
It's because of the pipe of Hamilton County is back there. It's a large sewage pipe that all the water drains, and there has to be a certain easement from that pipe forward in order to build a pool. Trust me, if I could put it there, I would, because I'd rather have it in my backyard. But it's just not an option.
I see.
So.
And it looks like, when I drove by there, that it from the street it drops immediately. Is that correct? This topography.
Yes, we do have a slope topography, and I do have Mid-America Pools. Pat Brennan is here, and he's the person who's helping me design the pool, so that way I can keep it in, you know, looking classy and pretty, and keep it private. And I also do have our president and our vice president of our homeowners. We had a meeting this week, and I addressed everyone who came there, anyone's concerns, and it was a unanimous vote to grant my variance for the fence. The pool on the side yard is not against our covenants in our landings of Anderson. It's just the fence, because I'm pushing it forward from the rear plane, and so that variance was granted. I am allowed to put a pool in my side yard in our subdivision. That's in our covenants, so as long as it's not an above ground pool.
Thank you.
Do you have some documentation of the homeowners association, or is the homeowner association?
Yes, they are here.
They're here to give testimony directly?
Uh-huh.
Fine.
Any other questions of the applicant? Thank
all
you.
Good. Thank you.
Would anyone else like to speak in support of this?
Hi. I'm Pat Brennan, Mid-American Pools, and I'm here with Jennifer. I just want to explain, if you could go back to that one set of pictures that was there. Can you go back to the one on the side of the house?
Oh, that one.
Yeah. If you look at the top right picture with the slide sticking out there, the elevation of the patio is probably 2.5 to 3 feet lower than the pool. You can see the retaining wall that's extended around on the side. that would be the elevation of the pool at that level. So it would be considerably lower than the street. So they're going to have to extend that little small 2-foot-high wall around part of the pool there. So it's actually going to be much, much lower than the playset that's there. And that pool will encompass a lot of the area where the playset is. So they would pretty much effectively reduce that impact of that structure and whatever's visible by 15 feet. That's just a round estimation, but I'm sure if I went out there and shot it and measured. So nobody will be able to really see that from the street, especially when it's bermed up and landscaped properly. We have done numerous ones with variances in side yards from place to place to place over the past 30 years. And as of now, I don't know of any negative impact we've had on anybody. So that being said, that's all I have to say. Thank you.
Any questions?
Yes, I do have one. Yeah, is there ahead. A landscape plan, especially for the front side, for the roadside of the pool?
Well, we discussed it out there, and they want to take some of the spoils from the excavation of the excess dirt and create some berms. And there's already plantings all the way along the street there.
Yes.
So they plan on adding some more, just little mounds with some dense foliage on it to create more privacy. So I think from an impact standpoint, it's going to make it a lot less than more.
Thank you. Would anybody else like to speak in favor of this? Or
I'm from the Homeowners Association.
Yes, please. Give
name. And I was not here for the swearing-in, so I don't know if I need to.
You do.
Okay.
You swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you God?
I do.
Thank you.
My name's John Frey, F-R-E-Y, and I'm at 2390 Shimmering Bay Lane, and I am the current president of the Homeowners Association. And Jennifer is correct. We discussed it at our last meeting on Tuesday. And our understanding, and we actually consulted our attorney, our understanding is the only thing we can really grant a variance to is a fence. We have no say whether or not they can put a pool in their yard or where the pool goes, anything like that. It's not in our bylaws. And so what we did is we took a vote on the fence last night, and the vote was unanimous and to grant the variance. So as far as we're concerned, the only thing that we would like to see is the same thing I think you all just asked about, which is landscaping and making sure that they do as much as they can to privatize from the street so that it's not an eyesore, or that it also knocks down the noise level, and not that we expect any noise, but that will also knock down the noise level. And I also asked if we could also include some evergreens so that even in the winter, from the street, the visual aspects will look good. So,
what?
Any questions for me, Willen?
No, perhaps I should clarify my question of why you were here. We should be taking direct testimony, and I was reluctant to listen to the property owner say that the Homeowners Association did this or that, so I was happy to see you here.
Okay.
I appreciate it.
Good.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Would anybody else like to speak in support of this? Would anybody like to speak in opposition to this? Yes, sir.
My name's Mike Decker. I live at 2245 Endo Valley, and I'm not here to speak for or against this as much as I'm here to ask a question and ascertain whether or not the proper studies will be performed before this project is approved. I'm questioning the dramatic decrease in elevation and the statement that no detrimental issues will occur to adjoining properties or properties in the neighborhood. That storm sewer that they keep referencing in this project is the beginning of the natural flow of water for a creek that runs behind all of the homes on Endo Valley. And we're already experiencing significant erosion issues. My neighbor right to the left of me owned, says that the creek has gone from 3 foot wide to about.
I don't think that was you.
Anyway, the creek has significantly widened. That's okay. I can talk loud enough. I don't need the silly thing.
Try this one.
Anyway.
We need to pick you up for the tape, so. We all turned our turned our mics back on, see what happens.
Okay. All right, is it good? I don't know.
Try turning just yours on.
Just 11 stays on.
Oh, it stays on. Okay. Is it all working right now?
Is it working? I don't know if it's working.
Can you speak into it?
I'm afraid it might bite me. All right. Anyway, I'm just here to make sure that somebody does the proper due diligence on the impact of water erosion from that storm sewer and from the natural creek that exists there right now. We have a significant flow in place today, but if you do a drastic decrease in elevation, is that going to send more water down that creek? If I put a great big cement patio area, is that going to send more water down that creek? So is there a baseline in place, and who will be accountable for future erosion caused by this topography change? That's all. I don't care if they put a pool in. Just don't ruin my property with sending more water down my way.
I just take it from your comments, you live downstream from this?
I live downstream from them, yes.
Okay. And how long has the erosion problem been ongoing?
It's been getting worse over the years because, you know, more water keeps coming down the creek. It keeps getting wider. For my neighbor Bill, the creek keeps getting wider. For me, the bend in the creek is where I'm at, and my fence posts that hold my fence in are starting to kind of tilt, and they'll be falling away in a year or two. If I get more water, they'll be falling away in a day or two. Mm-hmm. So.
Okay, thank you.
Any other questions? Thank you.
Thank you.
Somebody else can take it. Go ahead.
My name is Randy Corbett. I live at 7104 St. Edmunds Drive. I am here on behalf of Gerald Ash, who lives directly across the street from the property. And I don't want to read this letter if you guys all have received it. I don't know if it's... So that it's not a necessity to read through it. I can just touch bases on a few things. Okay. I stopped over there on my way here again today. The frustration, I think, for Jerry is it's right out front of his front door. You literally open the front door to his house, and unfortunately, I don't want to give you my iPad because you said you have to keep the photos, but I did bring a picture of on an iPad. I was able to download it on the iPad to see literally when you open the front door, it's right across the street from their front door. So you know, there's a concern of property value. There's a concern of noise. There's a concern of how it's changing the aesthetics of this neighborhood. These two houses are the first houses as it goes to the new section of Endo Valley. I'm not sure currently it looks more of a green space, and so the concern is it's going to change the aesthetics of the property. There is a community pool that no one's mentioned that is literally maybe within, I don't know, 200-300 yards from this proposed pool as well. Again, I'm just here to speak on behalf of Jerry. He had to be out of town for an event, and that's it. Any questions that I can answer?
And the Ashes live right across 2206, right?
Yes, sir.
And for the record, sir, you're putting the entire letter into the official record here?
Yes, please.
Okay.
Anybody else like to speak? Yes, please.
Nothing works after sitting this long. I live right behind. I'm sorry, I'm Janet Buck, 8242 Timber Creek Drive. We're the first house on Timber Creek, and Egan's are right in our backyard.
Okay.
First of all, everything they've done beautifully. I mean, very, very high class, very beautifully done. My biggest concern, I guess, is runoff into the creek, which is under the EPA or some government thing. I mean, they watch it real close. And we were concerned about runoff into the creek, the chlorine water, if that would affect anything. And I think that's my biggest concern, is just protecting the creek.
But other than the issue with the runoff, in terms of its location vis-a-vis your back deck and things, it's not a problem for you?
Oh, no. I think we're sort of up higher, and they've done beautifully a beautiful rock walk or whatever for drainage down there. So we're fine.
All right. Thank you.
Uh-huh.
Any other questions? Thank you very much. Would anybody else like to speak? If you could give us your name and address.
I'm Pierre Andre. I live at 2166 Endel Valley. That's up in the older section, about two doors up. And I've lived there for 42 years. And I think the thing that bothers me the most is the little creek that goes back of all the houses along Endel Valley is going to be affected by the pool. I think that if they drain the pool in the wintertime, that water is going to go into the into the creek. And that you go back to the picture with all the green space, that's all green space back there, and I think that should be protected. We fought awful hard to keep that when the original subdivision went in, and I just hate to see anything happen to that.
Any questions? Thank you. Would anybody else like to speak? Would the applicant like to, I'm sorry. People watching live on TV at a little entertaining that crazy.
Okay. Yes. Do I need to say my name and? At any rate, addressing the chlorinated water, there would be very little, if any, to splash out of chlorinated water. There's no backwashing of the filter. It's a cartridge filter, so there's not going to be water going into that stream. From a surface area standpoint, they're really not going to change. There'll be less surface area actually impacted because the pool is down 3 inches to maintain that water level for skimming purposes. So when it rained, it could take 3 inches of water in that pool and hold it. So there'd be less water than landing on the surface right now. That's what the one guy's concern was about runoff into the stream. It's not going to increase any water flow at all. The same surface area is there. It's just that whatever would rain on top of the ground would run off, that it couldn't absorb. It'll hit the paving, but there'll be a 3-inch buffer for approximately 600 square feet that it would just catch, like a reservoir. So typically they're not going to have 3-inch rains. Any water that would be pumped out would pump to the street if they had to winterize it or dump the pool. So you wouldn't pump it into the stream anyway. That's when we get a permit from Hamilton County, we put no discharge of water on that permit. So we wouldn't be pumping anything into that stream. When chlorine level's not high enough in a pool anyway to kill any little salamanders or crawdads, because it doesn't kill the people swimming around there.
Questions?
Okay.
I'd just like to respond to a couple of things that they brought up, just so we're all clear. I mean, I completely know what Mike Decker's going with the stream. We have actually contacted Anderson Township last year and Hamilton County, and they came in and dropped sandbags and more rock back there. So I think as a street, we probably need to, you know, continue to address that, because I agree that, you know, but that is not really in relation to the pool, and obviously I want my house to be standing afloat too. So I would take any, you know, safety precautions when, as we're installing that, to look at that. As far as the noise level, I mean, I have a playset there. I have three young children. We have a basketball hoop. We live in a subdivision of, you know, 97 homes. My neighbor across the street lives next door to a home that has three boys with a basketball court and a hockey rink in the backyard. So I can't really say that my three young children are going to be really causing a great more noise level than it has been. And I do plan on putting evergreens and privatizing it. Like I said, I don't want to just, you know, be installing something for, you know, everyone to see as they're driving down. And lastly, that is my lot. It's not green space. I do pay it. That's my whole parcel. So I have planted that grass. We have put every single bush and stuff on there except for two trees on that side. So I appreciate that everyone thinks it's beautiful, but I mean, we all pay for our property in taxes. So it's not a free lot for, you know, it's not a park. That is my house. So I'm going to keep it looking as beautiful as it does now, just with the factor of, instead of a swing set, and I do have a patio there now, instead of a swing set, no, I'd like to put a pool there for my children.
Any further questions? I have one further question. Uh-huh. Is this back as far from the street as it can go?
Yes, because of the easement that we have to...
further back. So this goes right back to the easement?
Not the easement of my home, but the easement of the pipe.
What? Mm-hmm. Thank you. Any other questions? This page, I'd like to, I think we have a couple of options in terms of public hearing on this. You know, we can close the hearing. We can also close the hearing and ask for further information to be submitted before we act on it. And I don't know what others' thoughts are. I, for one, have heard enough concerns about landscaping that I'd like to require the submission of a landscape plan before we make a decision on this. I don't know if you think that's overkill or not, but it certainly seemed to be.
No, and I agree with you, and I would include in the landscape plan the berm that was discussed here. That is not just the plantings, but the elevation, the planned elevation.
You think that's...
On the one hand, I think it's a pretty good idea. On the other hand, I did observe that the property is substantially landscaped, and I'm wondering what more landscaping could be put in. That's my personal view. I'm sure you can always put in more landscaping, but I would be comfortable if the board approved this with a landscaping requirement to simply require an additional planting of maybe a couple of evergreens. Like I was saying in the testimony point, it drops off anyway. It's hard to see. But the landscaping plan, there was a question of openness to the house across the street. But I found the landscaping to be pretty good as it is.
Brian, are you comfortable with making a decision without a plan, or do you think we should? And what would happen is we wouldn't entertain additional need to entertain additional testimony. We could close the public hearing get the landscape plan and at our next meeting take an action with that. Or we can decide to go ahead and make a decision without the landscape plan.
I think I'd like to see a landscape plan. I drove past the property, but I didn't take a look exactly what the neighbor across the street would, you know, see. I was in my car, so right. That might help.
In my inspection of the property, I got out and walked it. It was the main consideration that I wrote down.
Was the landscape plan.
Not so much for the neighbor across the street, but for the people moving up and down the street.
Yeah,
so that it was
I think
protected.
I'd like to have one part of the record myself when we made a decision, because as we've heard from the testimony, the current owners do a great job of landscaping and show, but you have to adopt a standard that assumes that they don't own the property, but I do, and my neighbors don't think much of my landscaping. So,
that's a good point.
Good point that my neighbors don't think much of landscaping. So, that being the case, Allison, what we're going to do then is close the public hearing, leave open the decision, and request that the applicant submit a landscape plan. I think we usually give them 2 weeks. Is that going to?
Yes.
Prior to the next meeting. I didn't know how much in advance of the next meeting you need that.
Including an elevation plan.
Okay.
An elevation drawing.
To give us an idea of the berm and where it sits vis-a-vis the street. We can't entertain anything further. I know, but I can imagine the question is whether that should reflect anything about drainage.
Well, the board hasn't approved it, although we're perhaps suggesting favorable treatment of it subject to landscape plan, but certainly when the case is decided, we can discuss the drainage.
No, the question is, do we need any sort of further information on the impact on drainage, whether to request anything on that or not?
Right. Well, you ask, well, I would say no. I am hear exactly what they're saying about the drainage, and that's a scary proposition when you have a drainage course behind your property that is eroding it. And we heard testimony that there's been contact with the proper authorities, including Hamilton County. However, if they were to put in, say, a wider driveway, an addition, et cetera, which would create the same amount of impervious surface and hence the runoff, there would be no requirement for that type of thing. And in my view, the runoff is going to be minimal anyway because the hard surface is going to be around the perimeter of the pool itself. So that's my opinion. If we were just in discussion, I would not see, although I think it's a problem, I do not see this contributing to the problem.
That was my exact understanding and interpretation of the issue, is that this is not going to increase the likely runoff at all, especially the testimony that we heard is any pumping of the pool would be out into the storm drains out onto the street.
Right.
So the natural runoff would not be increased. In fact, it would be decreased. I understand the neighbors' concerns about it, but I don't think we need to go into a great study on it.
Okay.
Yeah, I agree.
Okay, so at this stage, the request is for a landscaping plan showing elevation and mounting. And we will consider this case at the next month's meeting. We will not take any testimony at that. We will take what we've heard tonight and the landscaping submission and make a decision at next month's meeting. All right, that takes care of the public hearing part of our agenda. I think we've made it through all of them.
Mm-hmm.
I think we're going to, I would like to entertain about a 3 minute adjournment. Let us recess. I'm sorry, not adjournment.
Second.
And we'll come back in just a couple minutes.
You need
and
to vote on
that. All right. Thanks.
So here's your comments.
All right, we'll come back from recess. So far, the microphone seems to be working. Allison hadn't turned hers on yet. She's afraid to. I think during the recess, Allison and I were discussing and wanted to get on the record the discussion of the provision of the bylaws about what it takes on action, particularly in the first case where we only had three people hearing it. On that case, it takes a vote of all three to dispose of that case one way or the other.
Up or down?
Up or down. Mm-hmm. And if it does not take three, I think that's considered to be a tie vote.
Correct.
And would, as we would be required to schedule the case for a rehearing. Similarly, with four of us present for all the other cases, if it is 2-2, it is also considered a tie vote. So there would be a rehearing. Of course, you know, we obviously do straw votes first and then the formal vote. But so is that your understanding
yes.
as well?
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you.
Let me get back to my agenda here. Got a lot of papers. All right. First case is the one that Mr. Johnson has abstained from, which is the chicken coop at 1664 Beachshire Drive.
I'll start off, Mr. Hayes, if that's okay with you. Very, very interesting case, and I really like the fact, the idea of growing your own food, growing your own, having your chickens, organic, etc. And I realize that this is for a structure, not the fact that you're keeping the animals there. However, I think the intent of the code is, I believe, is that there is limits on the placement of the structure because, in reality, to have chickens survive in this environment, you need to have protection from them in the winter months. And I think our code is strikes a good compromise in that we really don't regulate keeping of that type of animal, in this case chickens. However, there is some realization that you should have the proper separation from your neighbors so it's not intrusive on your neighbors. Hence, I believe that's the reasoning behind having the 200-foot setback from the property line. In other words, if you had about an acre lot, you could put the chicken coop right in the middle and you'd make your setback just about. So I think there's some good reasoning behind our code. It strikes a balance. And when I saw the property, lovely neighborhood, I took a look in the back. It was a beautiful backyard. However, I didn't see any hardship there. I just saw a desire to have the chicken coop there. And I didn't feel that per our code there was appropriate separation. I think the variance is actually quite substantial. I mean, we're going from 200 feet to 17 feet. So I would not be in favor of granting it. Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, I completely concur with Mr. Eliff's position, except for the minor point, relatively minor point, that it's not 200 feet. Actually, the code says 100 feet.
100 feet, sorry.
But that's still a substantial change, 100 feet to 17 feet. But other than that, you said it eloquently, and I completely agree with everything you said.
And I'm there with you both as well. And I have another, we had this case last year.
Similar case.
And it does raise the question about whether the trustees want to change the zoning standards to address this issue. but I'm not comfortable that this isn't substantial. I mean, it is, once again, I always go to, you know, what if it's not the current property owner, but the next property owner who's got that chicken coop and the people behind them are not happy because it's not as well maintained as they would like. So I concur with both of you.
Further, we did not hear testimony on the health aspects of this in this particular case, but we did hear the health aspects in the similar case about a year ago. And that was part of our consideration, I think, in denying that variance at that time. So I think it's not just appearance of the positioning of the accessory building, it's also the health aspects because of the maintenance of foul there and the need for the 100 feet setback.
I don't think we've got that testimony in front of us for this case, so I don't think we can take that into account. But I do think we can take into account the concern that
consistency,
and that if we believe that it's, if we say, well, it's not substantial in this case, even though it's a very small backyard, there's a house behind it, there's, I think it's, I'm just very troubled by it. So I guess I'll entertain a motion.
All right, I'll try and form a motion for us in case number 6, 2013, 1664 Beachshire Drive. I move to that the board deny the requested variance to reduce the setback for an accessory structure to be used as a chicken coop from 100 feet to 17 feet and 20 feet. The property in question can yield a reasonable return without the variance. It's being used for a very nice single-family residence today in a very well-established and stable neighborhood. The variance is substantial, upwards of 80% reduction. The lot size is quite small as well relative to the variance requested. The essential character of the neighborhood would be substantially altered in that this board is really not able to fashion restrictions nor find hardship that would justify this, and we are talking about things such as how the owner might keep the property, tend to the chickens, etc., which something is not something we can legislate to control effectively. The variance likely would not have effect on government services. There was not testimony, but then we would presume that the property has knowledge of the laws in place, including zoning restrictions, when they acquired the property. The property owner's predicament could be feasibly obviated through some other method in that the code provides for this use as of right on lots of adequate size. Spirit and intent behind the zoning requirements would not be observed if this variance were granted.
Second.
I have one item I'd like to see included in there, which is also that there's a noise factor to take into account when you're putting something that close to a property line.
Yes, I would like to include that as well.
Okay, motion and a second. Betty?
Brian Ella?
Aye.
Fred Heinz?
Aye.
Rick Overton?
Aye. Okay, on that case, I assume that we will have Gary review before we journalize.
Yes, we'll draft the resolution and Gary look it over beforehand.
Okay, so that case we will get back next month for final action on a written resolution because we
time
want
is,
council.
Time to is getting late.
No, because council, we want council to take a look at the resolution. Case 7, 2013 BZA, the Anderson High School fuel canopy. I'd have bet money a high school kid took it out.
I was wondering about that.
Thoughts on this one? Brian? Brian J. Sorry.
That's okay.
I didn't disclose earlier. My wife's an employee of Forest Hills School District, but just a teacher at Sherwood, so she's not affected by any of this. I didn't see any problem. It obviously needs to be replaced. It can't be moved any without substantial cost. So it seemed like it was reasonable and adequate.
Thank you.
Yeah, I agree, and I think the four or five stipulated conditions there, I think, are reasonably met. The conditional use of the per section 357 of using it as a high school requires that some refueling be available there for the transportation parts of it. So I'm in favor of retaining that conditional use and replacing the canopy.
Right, and I'd agree. And just the only thing I would add is it's a little bit different. It's a big high school. They have a lot going on. And as I believe Mr. Hayes pointed out, the thing is the setback quite substantially anyway. So it's not having a negative impact and meets the stated criteria, I think, quite well.
Yeah, we also heard testimony that it's slightly larger, but that increase takes it further away from the property line, not getting it closer to the property line. It's on that east side, I guess, rather than the west side. I think we also, my other biggest concern was on lighting, but I certainly heard testimony that they'll be using shielding on the lighting. And we also heard testimony that to relocate it out from where it was, and I'm sure if they were building it today, they may not put it where it is. $500,000 sounds about right. That's a hardship.
Yeah.
But they may very well design it to be right about where it is because of the bus traffic in and out of there. Sure. They couldn't put it much further back into the athletic fields behind the property in the rear yard.
Yeah. So good point. Good point. I'll entertain a motion on this one. Go ahead, Fred.
Mr. Chairman.
Brian's looking the other way.
So sorry.
Mr. Chairman, with regard to case number 7-2013 BZA 7560 Forest Road, the fuel refueling canopy for the Anderson High School, I move that the board approve the variance and the conditional use. And in particular, the stipulation H, the vehicular use area, will not be altered through the replacement of the canopy. The replacement of the canopy will not introduce any new noise, odors, vibration, or dust in the area. There is no landscaping being proposed. In fact, landscaping would probably hinder the operation and make it more cumbersome. There is no signage being requested with this request. And the lighting, as we've heard testimony, will be pointed down and shielded away from any of the residential properties. In the evaluation of the variance, the property in question will yield a reasonable return. With continued use of a refueling facility there, this variance is not substantial. The essential character of the neighborhood would be substantially unaltered, so it would not be changed at all. The variance would not adversely affect the delivery of governmental services in any way. The property owner's predicament could feasibly be obviated in some other very expensive but probably not very a desirable location further back on the property. So it could not be reasonably obviated with any other reasonable action. So the spirit and intent behind the zoning requirement would be observed and substantial justice done by granting this variance.
Okay, Brian?
I'll second that.
I have a motion to second. My only request is when we put this in the final resolution to also note, we've kind of assumed it all the way through, that this is a replacement of a previous facility. It's not a new structure.
I agree.
The only comment I have, and that this is not an addition to the motion, but just interestingly, if the variance were denied, that would adversely affect the delivery of the government services significantly.
True. All right, we have a motion and a second. Betty?
Brian Owen?
Aye.
Bev Hayes?
Aye.
Brian Johnson?
Aye.
Rick Overton?
Aye. Okay, next up is 8-2013 Puppywood Pet Resort. Let me get my act together here. I'd like to lead us off on this discussion. Fred?
Mr. Chairman, I'm mixed on this issue. In many ways, I would like to see the board adopt and grant this variance, except for the one restriction that troubles me the most is that our code says that an outdoor run should be at least 200 feet from a residence district, and this isn't even close. But the rest of the structure and the plans and the control of the animals feels to me like I would like to grant this, but it is well outside of our code. And in addition to that, the applicant has stated that it would be possible to operate without the use of the outdoor facility. So I'm on the fence.
Bad pun.
I am too.
It's a bad pun.
I was going to use that pun intended. I think we probably couldn't ask anything additionally of the property owner it seems that he's going to make do everything that he could do to make the best possible situation. I thought that there was plenty of buffer from the back to the other residents. There are a couple of fences. I'm not sure about the people in the apartment. You know, they would have a view of the animals. I don't know what they would think of, on a daily basis seeing the animals. I didn't think there was a problem with the dogs getting out with the type of fence. I thought the noise would be lessened with that type of fence. I thought the Beachmont Avenue would, the noise of that would probably, go in with, kind of mask any barking dogs. But I think what the code says, that it probably would be substantial.
I'll echo those comments. I'm as I listened to the testimony, I was very impressed and grateful for the applicants to come in and reuse that space, first of all, but that doesn't have anything to do with the variance criteria. I have a concern with it and would be opposed to the variance for a couple of reasons. Primarily, it is substantial. We're going from 200 feet down to 76. The reason why you have a significant setback requirement for things like this is there's not a practical way to control it. You can't have the zoning inspector going to the business day in and day out, counting dogs, listening for dogs. There's not a practical way to do it. So what the zoning code has to do is come up with a way that you can control it and balance the quiet enjoyment of the residents
and the needs of the business. And what it does is it comes up with this setback. And I didn't hear testimony. I was impressed with the testimony I heard about the running of the business in Montgomery. That's a great community as well, and I'm sure they have very high standards also. I think some of the testimony I heard was speculative as well. I'm not sure about the idea of deflecting the noise up based upon the height of the fence. I'm not sure about the science on that. I heard numbers between 10 and 20 of the animals being outside. I don't know about keeping dogs like that, but I do believe that the applicant is correct that by being able to mix the dogs around, bring them inside, that probably does calm them, but I still think you're going to be having noise out there and noise that can be heard. We did hear some testimony. And so basically, I think, you know, it's just not within the powers of this board to be able to control the nuances and the details of the operation that, in my mind, I could comfortably support the outdoor dog run that doesn't meet the code and is a substantial reduction.
Yeah, I have a problem with this application for a couple of reasons. The ones I have cited in prior cases, the current applicant obviously has a good track record and of how he handles it, his business handles it, but if it's not his business, it's the next guy's business. Are they going to be as diligent? My second concern is I'm sure the people who own residential property behind it, frankly, probably suffer a fair amount by the increase of the size of Beachmont Avenue since that was developed back there in the 40s and 50s. And I think they're entitled to rely on a zoning provision that says it's going to be 200 feet from the residential property. We certainly know that the property owner acquired this property with knowledge of zoning restrictions, but I do think that it's substantial. I think it can be operated without it. I think the adjoining property owners, we certainly have testimony from them that they believe that it's going to detrimentally affect them, and I can't disagree with that. I would not be in favor of granting this variance. Any other comments? Or
no.
Not, we'll entertain a motion.
I'll reluctantly
your turn,
try this one.
Could you make sure that Mike gets up so that Betty can pick you up?
For case number 8-2013 BZA, 7863 Beachmont Avenue, I move that we deny the variance request to allow an 8-foot high privacy fence in the rear yard, where 6-foot is the maximum height allowed for the containment of boarded animals outdoors within 200 feet of a residence district. I think I move that the property will yield a reasonable return without the granting of the variance. It's possible to operate the business without the use of the outdoor area. Variance is substantial, and adjoining properties would suffer a substantial detriment as a result of the variance. And also, the tenant had knowledge of the zoning restrictions when he purchased the property.
We have a motion, and we have a second.
Second.
Betty, we have a motion and a second. Could you call the roll, please?
Brian Allen?
Aye.
Fred Hayes?
Aye.
Johnson?
Aye.
Rich
Everson? Aye. Okay, and that one also we will get formally drafted and take a final action on it next month. Case 9-2013 BZA, the garage that burnt down at 1002 Pamela.
Yeah,
I don't really have any questions or concerns with this. A variance seems well-suited for this particular situation. It's unfortunate that property burned down. The foundation is there. The setback is a couple of feet. There's nothing near it. There are similar buildings in the neighborhood. It's set back quite a ways. I don't think you even see it when you drive by. So I don't have a concern that it does not meet the variance standards. So I would be in support of it. Thank you.
Fred O'Brien, any thoughts?
My only concern on this was the height of that building, but the next door neighbor has a building, an accessory building of essentially the same height. So I don't think it's going to change the essential character of the neighborhood in any way. And the rest of the supporting evidence, I think, was properly stated by Mr. Eliff.
Yeah, he's basically replacing what was already there. I don't think I would expect him to move the whole foundation just to build, to replace it. And there are others that are neighboring ones that are similar, so I don't have a problem with it.
Yeah, I echo all those sentiments. Entertain a motion on this one.
I'll try and put together a motion in case 9-2013 BZA 1002 Pamela Drive. Move that the board approve the requested variance and finding that the property in question would not yield a reasonable return or have a beneficial use without the variance, and that the remaining foundation is in existence and would be of a substantial cost to have to not only rebuild that building but also have to remove the foundation a couple of feet over. The variance is not substantial. We're talking just a couple feet, and the building could be built as of right. The essential character of the neighborhood would not be substantially altered. We've seen evidence that there are similar structures existing in that neighborhood, and that there's no properties, the adjoining ones are open next to it. They would not suffer any detriment at all by granting this variance to allow the larger structure. It would not adversely affect delivery of government services. The property owner did not purchase the property with knowledge of the zoning restrictions, and that the evidence indicates when he built the initial structure that it was to code, and the code changed as he during his ownership. There is not a feasible way that he can obviate his predicament other than through a variance, and therefore the spirit intent behind the zoning requirements would be observed and substantial justice done by granting the variance, and would further add the requirement that the structure be built in compliance with the drawings submitted to this board, which are date stamped received April 18th, 2013, that the rebuilding commence within 1 year of today's date and be completed within 2 years.
Second. Motion and a second. Any further discussion? Betty, we have a motion and a second. Call the roll, please.
Brian Ella.
Aye.
Fred Hayes.
Aye.
Brian Johnson.
Aye.
Rick Overton.
Aye.
Very nicely done, Mr. Allen.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
No, what we'll need to do, as I indicated, those are all straw votes. For the ones that are approved tonight, staff will take a brief recess, and staff will type those up, and we'll take a formal vote and journalize, and they can pick up the action tomorrow, I guess. Mm-hmm. Or,
yep.
Yeah.
So after tomorrow, we can pick up the action and proceed.
The next thing on the agenda is discussion of bylaws. Now, I'm happy to entertain a motion that having heard five cases, it's one thing to put bylaws on the agenda when we only have one case, but I don't know if everybody's up for it or not.
We're doing on time here.
I'm in favor of that, of postponing until a future meeting, but I am interested in getting a clean copy of the bylaws as we have amended in email, if we're in favor of that, of those changes. I'd like to see a clean copy that we're ready to approve.
But I don't think we've had the, we have much of a
Well, there's been, just to be clear, there hasn't been discussion nor consensus building through emails. That would, of course, be done in this hearing room. What we have done is shared with staff our individual remarks. And so I think what would be helpful for me to see is, and I've seen some and others I haven't, is maybe all the remarks, or maybe a summarization if there's recurring themes or something like that, you know.
That's a great idea.
That might be helpful, and then that would give us a good starting point.
So if we could get
Sure.
two documents from you, a version that incorporates those comments that staff mm-hmm. believes that there was some consensus in the comments, or they were cleanup or whatever, and then to the extent that there were issues raised that perhaps staff feels needs to have further discussion, just bracket those or
Sure.
put them in there. And then if we could do that in a clean version, because some people read better off a clean version and a red line version. Okay. Some people read better off a red line version. That would be great.
So mm-hmm. That'd be really helpful.
That's not too,
yeah.
no, that's
too onerous. You're nodding yes. Betty's looking at me like.
Betty's looking at you like she's
really?
Gonna do it.
Like, really? So you run compare right then. All right, we're going to take a brief recess and let staff come up with some of those. Anyway, okay, we're going to come back from recess and look at what we've got here. Hopefully the microphones will continue to function.
We're going to try and do this on screen with you guys.
Well, we're going to do it on screen.
Because I don't feel like walking back to the printer.
All right, first case 7-2013 BZA, Forest Hills School District.
Do we need grant after appeals? On the fourth line?
Yes.
Thank you.
It's much faster.
Yeah, what's that mean?
I'm not plugged into our internet.
I think you can scroll down a bit for us. Or can we scroll ourselves?
No. Sorry. Can't let you have control. Let's go.
Yeah, that's good. Keep it there for a bit.
You're a little dizzy.
Substantial detriment, I think detriment's
Needs an eye.
Where are we at?
About in the middle there. Right above the four.
Right before the canopy.
Number three.
There you go.
Yes, no.
It's the right one.
It's going to look funny to me until I make sure. That's right.
That's right.
It looks weird.
That's right.
That's correct.
Turn spell check on.
Yeah.
And it tries to mess with our formatting.
Well.
Everybody through it so far?
Yes.
It's cannot, one word. Number five. Number five.
I was going to say that.
Cannot, one word.
Cannot, one word. Okay.
Okay. You ready to scroll?
There were no conditions on this one.
Correct.
That looks good.
You know, she just made the comment about no conditions. Is there any desire to refer to the plans? Are we okay with that? Can you scroll back up to the top to see where it just says requested variance? What do you think? Are you okay with that, or do you want to reference the plans?
I guess it wouldn't hurt to reference the plans.
Yeah, reference the plans.
Copy. And what's the date on those?
Those are April the 12th. Let's see, on April the 12th. Right?
Correct.
Sounds good.
Is it variances or variance?
Conditional use.
Conditional use. Are we condition, or is there a second? Is there a second condition?
Oh, following condition, singular. Okay.
Mr. Chairman, I move that this board approve and journalize case number 7-2013 BZA in granting the variance as documented.
Second.
Motion and second. Any further discussion? Not. Betty, could you call the roll, please?
Brian Ella.
Aye.
Fred Hayes.
Aye.
Brian Johnson.
Aye.
Rick Irvin.
Aye. All right. Pamela Drive, case 9, 2013 BZA.
This is just a setback variance, right?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so it should be granted. Where did I see variances? Let's see here.
Fourth one.
Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you.
Then should we, on one and two?
It should be the same.
Yeah, I mean, we ought to probably combine it, because we're saying the variance is not substantial, the proposed location, and...
I didn't realize that.
Yeah. And the applicant's requesting a reduction of only 2 feet. Let me just get rid of that. And then, do we say in here somewhere, do we note that this was replacing a previous structure?
Yeah, it's in number two. It's right before the three.
Oh, okay. Can we add at the end of that, replace the previous structure which was destroyed by fire? Thank you.
And then in number five, can I have one word?
Feasibly.
I was going to say, on four, I think he purchased it without knowledge of the zoning restrictions, because it was changed during his ownership.
Yeah, the current zoning restrictions, the current.
So it should say, purchase a property without knowledge of the current zoning restrictions. Yep.
How do we spell decrement? Is it T?
The I.
Where do we move the paragraph? Where do we purchase?
Substantial decrement, same one.
I can spell check's not getting that.
I don't know. Spell check's turned off. I'm ready to scroll down to the second.
Yep. Okay, that looks good.
All right.
That's all boilerplate.
We're good. Entertain a motion here?
Yes, I'll make a motion. Case number 9-2013, BZA 1002 Pamela Drive, that the board approve the requested variance and journalize as submitted.
Motion, do I have a second?
Second.
Any further discussion? Betty, could you call the roll, please?
Brian Ellis?
Aye.
Fred Hayes?
Aye.
Brian Johnson?
Aye.
Rick Overton?
Aye. Okay, I believe those are the only actions we're taking tonight. There will be two others that we will get formal action on next month when we have the typed up resolution. And then we will get the landscape plan and make a final decision on the swimming pool case. Is that it?
Next meeting is June 6th.
June 6th.
Are we likely to schedule the Martin Marietta?
More than likely to schedule something before that.
What's your, what's the sense of the incoming actions and variances?
I haven't denied anybody lately, but all of these came in 2 days before the deadline.
Just before the deadline?
Yes, so who knows?
So they can't even try to get a forecast.
No.
All right.
But we should come ready for the Martin Marietta.
Will you do Martin Marietta that night or a different night?
As long as the caseload is light, we can go ahead and do it that evening.
All right.
And you've got some tough scheduling of us as attendees because of that, right?
Yes.
And we have to make sure that the room's available.
Yeah.
Well, 6th is our normal schedule, isn't it?
6th is our normal meeting date.
Okay.
All right.
Okay.
Thank you all. There being no further business.
Motion to adjourn.
We've got a motion to adjourn. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.